Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Batliwala and Karani, it gives me great pleasure to once again host the post-result 1Q FY19 call of Indian Oil Corporation. Without much ado, I would like to hand over the proceedings to the management for the initial comments, and then we'll open the floor to a Q&A session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Bhavin, and good afternoon, friends. We in Indian Oil are there to address you on the quarter one results of FY19. Director of Finance will make the initial comments. We have with us Mr. Sandeep Kumar Gupta, the Executive Director of Corporate Finance, Mr. Rohit Kumar Agarwal, the General Manager of Corporate Finance, Mr. Avinash Singhal, the Senior Manager of Corporate Finance and Treasury, Mr. Sadashiv Nagnore, the Deputy General Manager of Corporate Finance and Treasury, along with me, Matthew, the CGM Corporate Finance and Treasury. So I will just hand over to Director of Finance to address you. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew, for that introduction. Dear investors and analysts, a very good afternoon to all of you once again. I take this opportunity to welcome all of you to this conference call organized today post-announcement of first quarter results. Though by this time you would have certainly gone through the accounts hosted on the website and also through the updates received by most of you, I would like to briefly dwell on the results to provide additional clarity insight. Before that, I would like to mention here that this time you would have noticed that our quarterly accounts are slightly delayed, and in fact we were generally doing it by the end of July, but this time it's August. The main reason is that we thought we will voluntarily opt for this consolidated quarterly result, which will become compulsory from next year on quarterly basis, but we decided we will start on a voluntary basis from Q1 this year. So that was an attempt, so that's why the delay, and hope that in the subsequent quarters we will be squeezing the timeline. Apart from that, you would have noticed one more thing that in our annual report for the last year, we have also introduced the integrated financial reporting from 17-18. So these are some of the progressive steps that we have taken. From this quarter, we have also adopted hedge accounting from this quarter onward. On the company side, the company has moved up few notches above in the Fortune 500 list from 168 rank to 137 rank, and continues to remain the top rated Indian company Fortune Global 500 list. Coming to the financials, during this quarter, the company has clocked a profit after tax of 6,831 crores, as against 4,549 crores during corresponding quarter last year. It's a jump of almost 50%. On a sequential basis, it shows a jump of 31% from 5,218 in last quarter. The income from operation during the quarter has registered an increase of 17%, primarily driven by the price increase, and quantitative changes are also there, and which translates to numbers to 1,49,747 crores as against 1,28,183 crores. On sequential basis, compared to previous quarter, the income from operation has increased by about 10%. Now talking about each verticals in brief, on refinery side, as we informed in last conference call, that now we are taking all refineries together, including the Paradeep refinery. So no separate mention about the Paradeep. During the quarter, our refineries achieved a capacity utilization of 102.4%, compared to 101.6% during the corresponding quarter last year. And this is despite the fact that the Paradeep refinery was under the planned shutdown for almost 22 days in the month of April. However, in this quarter, from May onward, the refinery is operating at almost 100% capacity. May, the capacity utilization was 101%, June was 97%, and July is 106%. So that was a shutdown which was taken for some regions in April. Basically, there was some issue on the hydrogen side. And the plant shutdown was taken. It was planned beforehand. Coming to the refinery efficiency parameters, the distillate yield in the refinery has touched 80.3% during the quarter, as against 78.6% in the corresponding quarter previous year. The fuel and loss was 8.6% as against 9% last year. Riding on the inventory gains, the refineries have registered a GRM of $10.21 per barrel during the current quarter, as against 4.32 compared to last year. So 10.21 is including the inventory gains, which compared with 4.32 last year. And as per the practice followed during earlier quarters, we have continued to work out the GRMs, whereby the inventory impacts are stripped off and price lags are also factored in to arrive at the normalized GRMs. Accordingly, normalized GRM for the quarter is 5.18 barrel as against 6.44 barrel for the last year, same quarter. On sequential basis, Q1 versus Q4, you will see that the cracks have shown a downward trend. During the quarter, MS cracks have come down by almost $1.2. These were basically 10.2 earlier and these are now 8.98. And HSD cracks have almost been at par with the previous period. Pipelines continue to generate the stable returns, giving EBITDA of 1,627 crores during the quarter compared to 1,590 crores in corresponding quarter last year, which is driven by the throughput increase by 7%. The marketing side, the total sales during the quarter have been at a steady level, with minor increases compared to the corresponding quarter as far as the quantitative side is concerned. Nevertheless, from a domestic perspective, the sales have recorded a 4.3% rise as compared to the first quarter, even on a sequential basis. Therefore, during the quarter, marketing has registered a healthy EBITDA of almost 400 crores, primarily driven by the domestic sales and reduced exports. Petrochemical side, at the cost of repetition, I would like to reiterate that our petrochemical vertical has grown to contribute handsomely to company's bottom line. Accordingly, during the quarter, Petchem business has reported an EBITDA of 1,630 crores. There is a reduction in EBITDA compared to corresponding quarter previous year, which is primarily on account of reduction and shrinkage of the cracks on LLDPE. As regards the borrowing is concerned, you would have seen that the borrowing as on 30th June have decreased to 44,797 crores as compared to 58,030 as on 31st March 2018. So this is briefly about the financials and about the company. So I now leave the floor open for the investors for the queries. Thank you for the patient listening.
Certainly, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Participants using speakerphones are requested to use the handset when asking questions. To enter question and answer queue, please press star and one on your phone now. If you would like to withdraw your question and exit the queue, press star and one again. We have a first question from the line of Pinakin Parikh from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir. So my question is, first of all, on Paradeep. Now, FY18, sir, we saw the ramp-up of the refinery. We saw the refinery hit a certain utilization rate. Now, going forward, sir, in this year, what do you think Paradeep should, in terms of the contribution to the refining segment? Now, the volume tailwind is behind us, but in terms of GRM, sir, how can it move higher from here based on its own efficiency?
See, why is that case? The whole thing depends on how does the refinery run. As I explained that from May onward, it is running at more than 100% capacity. So that itself is a testimony of the performance, and hopefully if the cracks remain favorable, I think the refinery will be generating very good GRM. As of now, it is difficult to predict the GRM, not only for Paradeep, but for any refinery. Because this whole thing will depend on the cracks and the absolute price of the crude. Because ultimately, if there is a continuous increase in the crude price, the fuel cost will increase. So I cannot predict the GRM, but I certainly can say there are no hiccups and there are no reasons why Paradeep will not give a very good GRM. Capacity utilization is good. Heavy crude intake is increasing in the refinery. So all these factors will contribute to the higher GRMs.
On a granular basis, if the blend, you said, you mentioned in the call earlier in your comments, sir, that $5.81 was broadly the adjusted GRM for the company as a whole. So Paradeep would be, where would Paradeep be, sir, on a similar metric?
See, in the first quarter, the Paradeep GRM will not be comparable because Paradeep, out of 90 days, 22 days it was under shutdown. The April month, the capacity utilization was only 23%. So right now, Paradeep number will not be comparable with the quarterly numbers.
Understood. And sir, my last question is on the petchem volumes, sir. FY18 volumes had come off. Should we see the volumes recover back to the averages we saw in F17, 2.55, 2.6 million tons? How should we look at the petchem volumes, sir?
Petchem volume, I don't see any problem. I think as far as the volume is concerned, volume will be maintained. The issue remains what will be the cracks. So that will determine the profitability, but volume will not be an issue.
Understood. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Vidyadhar Ginde from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon. So my first question was on the how much oil do you import from Iran? And do you have a term contract with it? And how do you see that panning out going forward given the sanctions which are likely to come into effect from November 4th?
Our contract with Iran is for 9 million metric tons per annum.
Okay, how much is imported until now?
The import is continuing on pro-rata basis. Basically, on pro-rata basis, the import is going on. What was the other question of yours?
No, so basically, how do you see this panning out? Because U.S. has been talking of the imports going down to zero by November 4, there is also hope that they may give some exemptions may be given by them. So how do you see that panning out? In a sense, will government play the key role? How do you see this panning out?
Yeah, I think that this is more of a matter of diplomacy and the relations between the India, U.S. and Iran. So I think the government will take the call on this. And we'll follow whatever is decided. As far as we are concerned, making up the quantity will not be an issue with us.
Correct. But you will.
Something is decided. Yeah.
So even now this month the imports are continuing on a pro rata basis. Nothing has happened. My second question was regarding the polypropylene capacity. So what's the timeline now?
The polypropylene
at
the expected date is December 18th.
Okay, so that it's progressing.
Yeah, 87% it was completed on 30th June. So 87% was the progress on 30th June.
Okay. And so that is when you will see the propylene production in the Paradip refinery
yes.
go up?
Yes.
Sir, what's the, are you producing any propylene right now or how does it?
No, right now, no, we are not.
Okay. Thanks a lot. That's it from me.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Mr. Aditya Suresh from Macquarie. Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify on two items, if I may. Firstly, just on refining. So again, assuming the same product crack environment in 1Q holds for 2Q, let's assume no inventory gains, no RTP pricing impacts. Is it fair to assume that you'll earn $5.20 in 2Q? Can you just confirm that?
It may not be 5.18 what we have said because it includes an element of the pricing price lag again. So it will be slightly less than 5. Less than 5.
Right. Okay.
Maybe
right.
somewhere around 4.5. 4.5.
Okay.
Yeah.
And as a follow-up to that, this pricing impact which shows as a negative item for refining, is it fair to assume an equivalent positive item shows up in marketing and that's why 1Q marketing was better than expected? Is that a fair comment?
Mr. Sandeep Gupta, our ED will reply.
Yeah, I'm Sandeep Gupta. Yes, I think, yes, there is a corresponding impact. The corresponding to this price lag impact in the refineries, there is a corresponding opposite impact in the marketing. So, the same we have not exactly quantified. But yes, principally, yes, there is an impact.
Okay. And then the final question I had was on your fuel and loss. Can we expect any improvement in this position over the next 1 to 2 years?
See, in terms of the percentage fuel and loss, it has been our endeavor to constantly improve on this. And you will see that there is a continuous improvement happening on this side. But as far as the value is concerned, the whole thing will depend on how does the crude price move. If the crude prices move up, probably the value of the fuel and loss will go up. But as it is, things remaining same, our endeavor is to bring it down by another 0.1 or 0.2 percentage point.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Probal Sen from IDFC Securities. Please go ahead, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. First question was a follow-up on what the previous questioner asked. When you say that, you know, normalized margins would actually decline a bit because pricing gains will not be there, I just want to understand if Paradip actually operates at full capacity utilization.
Would
that not offset that impact, sir?
Yes, you are very correct. Yes, I missed that because we never actually forecast the GRMs. But because that was a question, so I gave them. You are very correct. The Paradip, because it is now running at 100%, it will make an impact.
And
we are also hopeful that the Haldia Coker, which is in the process of commissioning, will also by November. So will also play a role in the improvement of the GRM and more heavy crude processing in Paradip. So probably it may come close to 5, but it's difficult to predict.
No, got that. I just want to clarify that point. That's one. Second, with respect to the, can we get a number on the exact percentage of FO that is produced overall for the company today?
FO percentage, we'll give you.
Sure.
In the meantime, if there is any other question.
Yeah, lastly, I just had one more in terms of if you can just give us slightly more segment-wise CAPEX guidance for FY19 and 20, if you have, sir.
That I can give you. The CAPEX guidance for division-wise. So, for 18-19, the refineries, 8,500. Pipelines, 2,300. Marketing, 5,800.
Sorry, marketing was how much, sir?
5,800.
Okay.
And petrochemical is another 2,100. And then there are others, ENP and others. So that makes up to almost 22,800 or so. ENP is another 400. Gas schemes, another 600.
Okay.
Actually, broadly.
Sir, does this include any capex on the West Coast refinery at all?
No.
This excludes any anything that can that might come up.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Sir, should I tell you? The FO is about 4% on the total crude.
Okay. I'm asking this in the context of this whole news about the IMO regulation, sir.
Yes.
And whether we are in a position to sort of either upgrade this to low sulfur FO or, you know, how do we plan to tackle it if the recommendations are actually implemented come FY20?
We have the twin action plan. One is the reduction of the FO, as you are saying that in Haldia, the FO production will come down. We have some plans at Mathura also to bring down the FO. And at the same time, we also want to take advantage of the opportunity which is coming in view of the IMO guidelines. So we will plan to produce some bunker grid, taking the call on opportunity available. So that those plans are also in our drawing board.
Okay, fair enough, sir. I'll come back if I have more questions. Yeah. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Sabri Hazarika from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. Wanted to have some sense on the marketing margin of various products over the last two quarters sequentially. I mean, March quarter versus June quarter. So how has it behaved in petrol, diesel and other products?
Okay, I explained in earlier conferences also that there is no movement in the marketing margins as such. So marketing margins are generally not tinkered with. These remain flat. And the movement in the prices is governed by various factors, the international prices, transportation, delivery charges, taxes, primarily by that. There will be marginal changes in the marketing margins.
Okay, so what we have seen in the last under certain periods that the implied margin based on your own price built up has become depressed because of elections or whatever which was going on. So can you confirm that or it is more or less not that intense?
I think the sequentially you can compare the marketing margins with the earlier quarter.
Okay, sir, fair enough. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Manikanta Gare from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. May I request to give some more color on the CGD sector wherein we have won 16 geographical areas in the recent bidding round.
Yeah, CGD. I would like to just give you the number. In the total geographical areas, the IOC actually participated in the bids in three capacities. One is that IOC standalone, other is IOC with Adani, and the third was IOC, there is a green gas, which is JV with GAIL. So I will give you the numbers. So IOC standalone, we participated in 34 GAs, geographical areas, out of which the bids have now been opened for 30, and we have won 7.
Yes, So can you please give us some guidance on the volumes and the capex? I think as we mentioned, the 20,000 crores would be spent over 7 to 8 years. What is the volume that you are expecting here, sir?
I'll just complete the numbers. In where 20 years we have participated in JV with Adani, out of 20, the bids have all been opened for 20 and we have won 9 there. In case of green gas, where we have JV with the GAIL, we participated in 3 and all 3 bids have been opened and we have won in 2 cases. So out of so far 53 cases, we have won in 18 cases. So as far as the capex numbers are concerned, I think we will be sharing those numbers based on the, there are, one is that it all depends on LOI, when the LOIs are issued and when we start commissioning the work. So it will be too early to give you the capex number right now. So maybe by next quarter some directional number will be available. In any case, this year the capex numbers will be very low, because things will take time in mobilizing, ordering and other things.
Got it, sir. Sir, if I can ask one more question about the others segment that is being shown as a loss in EBITDA contribution of around 283 crores. Can you give a split of that others?
Actually, foreign exchange loss on our loan portfolio is not allocated to any divisional EBITDA, and that is accounted for under the head others. So you would see that foreign exchange loan on foreign exchange loss on other than crude liability is about 870 crore. So that is primarily going into others.
Okay, so that implies there is around 1,000 crores of profitability from other segments.
Yeah, no, broadly you can back calculate that.
600 crores of.
600, yeah, that would be correct.
Okay, so what would. What comprises of this 600 crores, sir?
Loans mein 871 crore is on account of exchange fluctuation on loan. That is the figure.
Yes, sir. If we take it into account, others would show as 600 crores of profitability, right?
I think we are getting into the nitty-gritty of the 600. Probably we'll be able to give you the figures separately. Is it okay with you?
Yes, sir. Fine. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Ms. Aishwarya Agrawal from Reliance Mutual Fund. Please go ahead, ma'am.
It is Aishwarya, Mr. Sir, can you please help me with the status of this West Coast refinery project in terms of where we are and what are the milestones and how things will move?
Abhi to West Coast mein the jo updates are almost available to you now. The land acquisition for the work is continuing, so no significant change.
Matlab sir, ye isme order kab tak jayega aur kya isme 1.5 saal aur wait karna chahiye and then the orders will be placed?
DFR itself is being worked out, so wo sab chalega abhi kaam. DFR itself will take time. It is being prepared, so it will take time. And land acquisition ka kya status hai? So maine aapko bataya, land acquisition abhi the things are in progress at different stages, so we'll have to wait.
And sir, one more question on this, your Ennore terminal. I mean, where we are, and October se wo start hone wala tha, and the volumes here 1.5 million ton is what we are talking. So abhi, what is the status?
Ennore LNG ka 95% it is complete as on June. So that was the question as on June. And scheduled completion is expected to be October 18. So it's not too far now.
And the volume, sir?
Volume ka kya matlab? Initially 1.5 million metric ton. The total capacity is 5, but it will start with the 1.5. That is the initial volume that we are targeting in first year.
and the pipelines jo kuch 20-25 kilometers are pending, that
so us par work is now going on and it is aligned with the completion of the terminal, so some approval in between for some 600-700 meters is pending. That is with the government, nothing to do with the locals and others, so that will come.
Okay, sure, thank you sir, best of luck.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Chinmay Gandre from Future Generali. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you for taking my question. Sir, if you can just reconcile like the GRM numbers which you have mentioned. So, I mean, total GRM is around $10.2. And in the press note which you guys have released, it says that the inventory gain is around $6.8. So, which means the core GRM would be around $3.4. Then you mentioned that adjusting for the, you know, I mean, timing difference, you have a 5.2 number, and then you also gave another number of 4.5. So, I mean, if you can just reconcile how you reached to 4.5.
Yeah, actually, the numbers which you initially told, 10.21, as against that, the normalized GRM is $5.1 and dollars per barrel, which is the combination of two adjustments. That is, one is inventory gains, and the second is the price lag. So 5.18 is the net normalized GRM. The number which DF spoke, 4.5, was against the question that if everything remains unchanged, what could be the GRM going, GRM say in quarter two? So in response to that, he said it may be $4 to $4.5 per barrel. Mm. But as in the subsequent questions you would have noticed, he also mentioned about the GRM increase which will be there as a result of Paradip commissioning,
Haldia,
and at other locations like Haldia, etc., because of coker commissioning, etc. So, and as the prices are, the situation of prices and the cracks is not certain, it will not be fair to give any guidance on the GRM numbers for going forward.
So price lag quantum could be roughly say 0.7.
No, it is 1.75. So, as you mentioned, $3.4 per barrel after netting off the inventory gain. And then you add $1.75 towards the price lag. So,
okay.
So that makes the normalized GRM $5.18 per barrel, which we should compare with Singapore benchmark margin.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have the next question from the line of Sanjay Mukim from Bank of America. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Sir, I had a question on the marketing EBITDA as you report every quarter. There is significant variance even if you adjust for the inventory gains and losses as you report them. And especially in light of your comment that marketing margins are stable and they do not move too much quarter to quarter, why is the marketing EBITDA so volatile?
I think the marketing, I don't know whether you have now shared the number correctly, there is hardly matlab any movement in the overall marketing EBITDA.
About 2,000 crore. It has been about.
Kya hua? Margin? Main to more or less, ek second, kya hai? Where is that? Just a second. On margin side, to nahi hai marketing EBITDA. I think some inventory gains are there in this.
Yeah.
But even if you take out the inventory gains as you report them,
inventory gains in marketing is how much? It's not inventory gain.
No, EBITDA excluding inventory gains, it is flat actually.
Inventory gain ka figure de denge to ho
jayega. 4369
is reported. Inventory gain is 1,968 crore. If you exclude that and you exclude the inventory impact, then the marketing EBITDA is comparable as 2,402 now compared to the 2,168 in Q1 last year and sequentially 2,429. So 2,168 last year, 2,429 in Q4, and 2,400 in Q1. So I think fairly stable and flat.
So should we not be adjusting? Correct. Should we not also be adjusting for some forex losses in marketing, or is that completely out of the subs? Because this quarter you would have a forex loss.
Forex losses are separately accounted for.
Yeah.
So there is no forex loss element at all in the marketing EBITDA that you are reporting? Okay. And then if I may follow up, sir, this quarter there was clearly periods where the margins on petrol and diesel were well below what they should be or well below what they were in the sequential or previous quarter.
Mm-hmm.
Yet if the EBITDA is flat both sequentially and YOY, we can't seem to think of a reason why that may have happened, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as you would have noticed from one of the questions of the previous analyst, there is a corresponding impact of price lag in the marketing also.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because marketing division is
realizing
the prices from the market at the latest prices and the latest exchange rates. At the latest exchange rates, whereas the purchase price is at the lower price. So there is a gain at marketing because of this also, which is offsetting that price modulations, whatever you are talking about.
But if I understand
plus
it,
plus there are certain conversion of export sales to domestic sales.
I
so
mentioned that because this time, though there is marginal change in the quantity sold by marketing division, but as it makes, the exports have come down where we do not make money and the domestic sale has gone up. So that has made the difference in improving the overall position. But one thing which I now can say is that what Mr. Gupta was mentioning, because of the exchange fluctuation, the overall value increases. So there could be some additional gain because of that to marketing, which is not named or ascribed as
exchange
fluctuation. But it becomes part of the price. Exchange fluctuation is separately accounted for, but that becomes part of price. So that would have also made some difference.
Right. Sir, and just to complete that point, the lag that we're talking about is the last fortnight of the quarter, right? The 14 days for which the RTP doesn't adjust for marketing?
Yes, yes.
It's just that 14-day lag that we should try and model if we can.
Yeah, in case of SKLPG, it is 1 month, and for other products,
right,
it is 14, yeah.
All right. Thank you very much. That answers my question.
Thank you. We have the next question from the line of Mr. Sumit Rora from Smart Sun Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. A very good evening. Sir, my question to you is more on the marketing point of view. You know, sir, I mean, you know, I keep reading a couple of reports, you know, which continuously keep stating that, you know, because of the upcoming elections and the upcoming election in May 2019, you know, marketing margins will be subdued. But, sir, I just heard what you said, that marketing margins have been very stable, you know, off late. So can we assume that marketing margins will continue to be stable and there's no reason for the, stocks to, in general, sir?
Yeah, it is fair to assume so. Yeah.
Okay, and sir, thank you very much, sir. And my second question, sir, is on the GRM point of view. I just heard you explain that. But, sir, you know, just one observation which I had was that after the weakness in June, GRMs actually now have moved up to about 6.5, you know, on the Singapore GRM. So because of all the, expansions and Paradeep kicking in, can we assume that, we should at least be able to be close to the Singapore GRMs? Is that a fair assumption?
As far as close to Singapore GRM, I think that should be something which is achievable. But as I said, forecasting GRM will be very difficult because various factors display. On efficiency side, performance side, yes, I think the refineries will perform well. And it should be comparable with Singapore.
Okay, got that, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And it's very heartening to know that marketing margins are very stable and they'll continue to be stable, sir. Thank you very much for your clarification.
Thank you. We have the next question from the line of Nitin Tiwari from Antique Limited. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good afternoon. Thanks for taking my questions, a couple of them. So if I heard you right, you were saying that the marketing margins have been stable and because whatever price modulation happened on the pricing end, that was offset by your procurement price. So does that mean that the refinery segment was adversely hit to compensate the margin, the marketing margin?
We have
one
never said about modulating our procurement price. This is all internal because there is no procurement by marketing division. It's all our product getting transferred to marketing division as such?
Okay, sir. And secondly, if you can help me understand the inventory gain part a little bit. So, what is the days of inventory that we are basically using as benchmark for our calculation in the refinery and as well as on the marketing side? One is that. And second is, there a portion in inventory gain which, given some more time, could have actually translated into the core GRM? In terms of, like, you know, is there some intermediate stock or something like that which, given some more processing time, could have actually resulted in the final product and hence the core GRM?
Can you repeat the question in different words so that we are able to understand? Can you word it differently?
Sure. So what I was asking is that how many days of inventory actually you use for calculating your inventory gains on the refining side and on the marketing side? That is one part. Second part is, given that there is a huge inventory gain number in this quarter, so is there any portion of that gain, like, you know, which is transferable to the core GRM because it's probably intermediate stock or unprocessed stock which would have, like, you know, further process resulted into a final product and hence would have reflected in the core GRM and not in the inventory gain? I mean, like, is there a shift possible from one segment to another segment? That's what I'm trying to understand.
One segment means one quarter to another, or I could not...
No, within the entire GRM of 10.2, if we look at the inventory gain is about 6.5, about 3.5 is the core GRM, right? So is there a segment in the inventory gain of 6.5 which, if further processed, could actually translate and move towards the core GRM and add to the core GRM?
No, actually, this inventory gain, basically, Indian Oil is holding almost a similar level of inventory at every period end. Okay. So this inventory gain represents the difference in the opening and the closing rate of the inventory corresponding to the inventory holding. Okay. So, your next question.
So, how many days of inventory is this, and on the refining side and on the marketing?
Root the 45 days inventory we hold.
IHG 7.
And the semi-finished car, it is 7 days stock that we hold.
7 days, you said, right?
Yeah. And crude is 45.
Okay, sir. And sir, last question is on your refinery capex and upgradation project. So there were a lot of, like, you know, upgradation projects that you were undertaking, and I believe you said 8,500 crores is what you're looking to spend on the refinery's assets, right? So I just wanted to, like, get an update on all those upgradation projects and which one are completed, which one is where. So if you can help me with that.
Completed means these are all will get completed by next year only, because DS6 car, and the date is 2020. The major projects will be, BS6 mein, the all projects put together, this year is 4,600 crore, that's what we will spend.
Okay.
And one project which is going on in Max at BGR, Bogegaon, that is another all 750 crore there. And then there are projects going on in Gujarat and Baroni, 800 crore. Haldia, Coker, so these are the broad breakup of 8,500 and refined.
Okay.
So
Gujarat,
I think the Coker, which is getting completed in Haldia, most of them will be spilling over to next period as scheduled.
Right. So if you can just help me understand what is the project that is there in Gujarat and Baroni? You're putting up additional coker unit, or what is that?
Gujarat and DS4 ka chal raha
hai na. So Gujarat, we are talking about an expansion which is from 13.7 to 18 million metric tons per annum. Okay. That's one which is having a first stage clearance, which we will be embarking upon. In that, there will be one new atmospheric unit to replace the four ones. and there will be improvement in the distillate yield and SSD maximization also. This is what is expected of the Gujarat expansion.
Right.
But that is in the first stage.
Right here, now, we BS4, units are being readied for BS4. That is the project which is on which the actual spending is right now happening.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just to clarify, if you're talking about 8,500 crores to be spent this year, this is for Gujarat, it will be only for BS, the BS4 stuff. And for
Barauni also BS4.
Yes, Barauni also the same. It's only quality upgradation for this year.
Right. Fair. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Manikanta Gare from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question again, sir. Just want to confirm with you on how much of heavy crude was processed in Pardeep refinery. I think last year it was mentioned that around 13% was processed and the design capacity is 40%.
We'll get back to you on this number because Pardeep was under shutdown for 22 days, so we'll have to work out the equivalent number and tell you. So we'll
okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a next question from the line of Mr. Chinmay Gandre, Nirali. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, sir. Thank you for taking my question again. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for taking my question again, sir. Sir, you mentioned that total days of inventory for the marketing division, which is only 7 days.
I mentioned the 45 days crude inventory and intermediate, the semi-finished goods.
Semi-finished.
Is the inventory at the refinery. It's 7 days, semi-finished, 7 days.
So what would be the inventory days?
Marketing will be, matlab, products will be marketing and refinery put together will be 25 days.
Product side, so basically your diesel, petrol and LPG and all
together would be product inventory held both in marketing as well as in refinery, so it is 25 days.
Only in marketing would be how much?
22
days. And sir, you mentioned the crude inventory is 45 days, but I understand that like because Paradeep is a coastal refinery, so I mean I believe that the average inventory that we hold in crude would have gone down by now.
Would have gone down by now is compared to what?
So earlier our crude inventory was around 40 odd days, but post Paradeep I thought it would have gone a bit, it would have gone lower. Or even for Paradeep we are holding crude inventory of 40.
I don't think there will be significant change because one is capacity, the other is that is related to the number of days sales and others production. So, and some transit time impact will also be there because additional transit time. Not much of change will be there.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. As there are no further questions in queue, I now hand over the floor to the management team of IOC. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this does conclude your conference call for today. We thank you for your participation and for using iJunction Conference Service. You may please disconnect your lines now and have a great evening ahead. Thank you.